soft matters. Talking physics, talking life.
Today on the Physics Factor, I have the pleasure of interviewing Itai Cohen, one of the physics professors here at Cornell University. Thank you so much, Itai, for joining me today.
My pleasure.
One thing I always like to know when I meet physicists is how they got interested in physics in the first place. So what's your story? How did you become a physicist?
Through my undergraduate research experience.
Okay.
I was picked out by one of the faculty who was teaching my honors chemistry course. And they recommended me to Dan Kivelson, who was a real pioneer in undergraduate research experience.
So it was a newer thing.
Yeah, back then it was a newer thing. I basically worked in his lab, and honestly, I didn't know what the heck I was doing for the first 3 years. And then the summer before I graduated, we figured it out. We were working with a chemical called triphenylphosphite, and Dan had actually been working on this chemical for 10 years. And we just discovered, like, I still remember the day that we were in the lab and we were looking at the material, and all of a sudden it dawned on us that what we were seeing was a liquid-to-liquid phase transition.
Oh.
And that was the first, one of the really first clear examples of that kind of transition, and that summer was wild. It was like staying in the lab all night, sleeping on my advisor's chair. He had this big fold-out sort of leather chair, and I slept on that chair. It was all very wild and crazy, and we were able to get all this research done in a very short amount of time, and that got me hooked.
It's just exciting.
It was fantastic.
NSF, you need to keep funding REUs.
Absolutely. REUs is key.
Could you tell us a bit about the types of questions your research group is investigating?
In general, the themes entail something to do with motion.
Okay.
Motion on different length scales. Maybe it's the micron length scale, and then it's Brownian motion that we care about, and how that influences the growth or mechanical properties of materials, like colloidal suspensions. We look at the flight of insects and try to understand something about the mechanics of the actual wing motions and how they lead to maneuvering, or what sort of forces the insects are applying at the hinge in order to get their wings to move a certain way. We care about the motion in biological tissues. We can actually move materials, we can shear them, take images as we're shearing them, and figure out how their microstructure relates to their macroscopic mechanical properties. Then you can start to apply these to biological tissues, and that actually has been a real boon. And for example, in the knee cartilage, we found that if you look near the surface of the cartilage, okay, in this region, there's a very compliant region.
Okay.
But if you look deeper in the tissue is much stiffer.
Okay.
But just the top 300 microns of the cartilage turn out to have totally different mechanical properties from the rest of the tissue. And in fact, when you look at energy absorption, all of it happens in that upper 300 microns.
So it's all happening right here.
Right at the very, very tip. And then if you wear down that tip, then we think that's when arthritis starts to take hold and destroy the rest of the tissue. So this is the protective layer.
300 microns.
300 microns, that's all you got.
That's about a third of a millimeter.
Yeah.
You don't know what a micron is.
Yeah, not very much. And if you damage it, right, if you really like have an impact or some kind of delamination, that could spell trouble for you, as the rest of the tissue is now no longer protected.
Okay.
And so we think that's how cartilage progresses. Still a hypothesis, but that's what we're working towards.
Mm-hmm.
And now we're getting into things like mosh pits. So I don't know if you've seen the mosh pit craze, but students love to go to heavy metal concerts. And so we and Jesse noticed all of these collective motions that were happening there. So we decided to analyze that.
You told us a lot about your work, and I think everyone has their own work-life balance for getting science done. And a lot of scientists do have hobbies outside of the things that they're studying every day, even though the projects and the ideas that we're working on can be very consuming. So if you wouldn't mind telling us a bit about your life outside of physics, what sorts of things do you like to do for fun?
Sure. So let me just say first that the job is fun. This isn't a 40-hour week job.
Right.
So it has to be fun in order for us to stay engaged. That being said, I don't work Saturday, so Saturday is my day off.
Mm-hmm.
I take it just for myself to do whatever it is that I want. This is a long-term sustainability issue.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you want to be able to make it over the long run.
Right.
And so you need to work, but you have to be able to keep some sort of balance that keeps you sane. That's
right.
How I see it. Recently, over the last few years, I've been dancing, and so I like to salsa. I'm trying to learn tango, but that's really difficult. Argentine tango, and that is a really hard dance for me, so I'm still learning. And then there's other stuff that I care about, which is communicating science,
mm-hmm.
and it's kind of part of the job, part not. We did a performance called Dance of Scales, and we put together a a performance for the Light and Winter Festival here in Ithaca, where we basically talked about how motion changes depending on your length scale. So on the very small scale, it's Brownian motions, and the intermediate length scale, we talked about Stokes flow and time reversibility in those flows, and on the big scale, inertia and things like that. And at the same time, the dancers were sort of making up movements that had that went with each one of these different segments. And then at the end, they sort of, I stepped off the stage and they performed the dance of scales, which was some, you know, inspired combination of these different movements. And I thought that was really terrific. And then, you know, beyond that, there's all sorts of just the normal reading, you know, movies and all the rest of that stuff. You know, that doesn't stop when you become a professor, you know. I have a dog, so I go to the park and I play with him, you know, we're together, it's the dog and myself and the ball.
That's good. You know. Well, thank you so much for talking with me today.
My pleasure. And I love science fiction movies, especially bad ones.
Bad science fiction
is like fantastic. That's
the
like
core.
The best.
That's
the
one
core.
Of my favorites.
The core was fantastic. Unobtainium. Perfect.
The other great part is when the one physicist is chanting, now your torque is your R cross F, like it's going to save the world.
Exactly.